Available now from Graphic Audio.
Tell me, Kip. If you've done bad things your whole life, but you die doing something good, do you think that makes up for all the bad?
No.
Me neither.
But it's better than nothing. Orholam is merciful.
Wonder if you'll say that after they're done with your village.
Gavin Guile is the Prism, the most powerful man in the world. He is High Priest and Emperor, a man whose power, wit, and charm are all that preserves a tenuous peace. A peace that is slowly rotting from the inside out.
This is all that's left of what was once a great civilization. Statues of great men, broken by the pygmies who follow. Let me tell you something you already know. Something that all of you have believed, but no one dared to say. The wrong Guile won the Prism's war. They killed him because they were worried he would change everything. They feared him because Dazen Guile wanted to free us. Dazen knew that light cannot be changed.
As darkness slowly encroaches upon the land, Gavin receives a mysterious letter.
I'm dying, Gavin. It's time you meet your son, Kip. Lena.
As Gavin races to find his son, he learns of a new and dangerous threat to his empire. A man who calls himself King.
Your time is finished. Yours and the Chromarians. You're done! Light cannot be chained. Know this, Prism. We will take back what you've stolen. The horrors of your reign are almost at an end. And when it ends, I will be there. This, I swear!
With the death of his empire looming, Gavin will be forced to wage a war on multiple fronts. But little does he know, his assassin may be looking right before his very eyes.
You're a stupid, stupid boy, Kip. But maybe a dull sword can go where a sharp one wouldn't be allowed. Don't you forget this. Don't listen to him, you hear me? He's a liar. You will not fail me in this, Kip. You learn, and then you kill him.
Yes, Mother?
Kip, if you ever loved me, avenge me. Swear it by your worthless soul, Kip.
I swear to avenge you, Mother, by my very soul.
Don't miss the beginning of the end in Brent Week's critically acclaimed new series, The Lightbringer Trilogy. Book 1, The Black Prism, Parts 1 through 3. Available now in Graphic Audio. Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Rogue Angel number 24,
The Bone Conjurer.
Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Terence Aselford, Thomas Keegan, Tom Simpson, James Konicek, Richard Rowan, Scott McCormick, Andy Clemence, David Coyne, Joe Brack, James Lewis, Casie Platt, Elizabeth Jernigan, Yasmin Tuazon, Kimberly Gilbert, Ken Jackson, and Christopher Graybill.
Cool palace walls offered welcome respite from Granada's thick August heat. Dust clogged the back of Garin Braden's throat. While journeying from the Christian lands of Castile to the great Muslim palace of Alhambra, the two men had stopped frequently and rested much. His master's horse was a 14-hand destrier of Arabian blood, but bred more for battle than long-distance travel. Garin's own mount was a pale rouncy dusted with red clay from the roads, on its last legs, surely. Their greater destination of Rouen, France, his master had been called to protect the Maid of Orléans, would not be achieved with this horse. Tugging the hood from his head, the young man wandered down a tiled aisle that stretched along a vast pool of indigo water. He could feel the coolness rise from the surface. The water did not stink, which he would have expected from so large a pool. Resisting a dive into the water would be a trial, but he'd been warned to exercise his best behavior in the palace. The Sultan did not take kindly to interlopers. They'd been given a brief tour and left to linger in this, the Sarayo, which his master, the Frenchman, had mentioned was built less than 100 years earlier. Elaborately detailed carvings on the walls, arabesqued in precise wooden curves. Hand-painted colors were vivid jewels set into the design. The courtyard was open to the sky, and bright morning light illuminated everything. It was blinding. Garin had never before seen such a blatant display of riches and appreciated what coin and barter could bring a man. Someday, he would have riches of his own. Garin missed his father, a German knight, but the man had never so much time for him as Rue offered. Rue, he followed everywhere. Rue was master, teacher, reluctant friend, and rarely, father. Garin learned much during their travels. He thought he would never cease to marvel at all the world and its riches could offer. Yet, he looked forward to a future with no master.
Ahead.
Inside, a long hallway edged the courtyard. Here in the shade, it was much cooler. Garin looked at the walls, his eyes traveling high to marvel over the intricate arabesque work carved into fine, varnished woods. It was a style he had not seen before traveling to Spain. It was decadent and pleased him to look upon it. Rue hastened his steps, but Garin meandered behind him at his own pace.
Ah, Alfonso!
The two men exchanged kisses to the cheeks while Garin hung back. Even when Rue walked in through the long strands of wooden beads to the alchemist's lab, he did not gesture for Garin to follow. He merely expected he would. The young man did, because he knew it was expected.
Someday I will not follow you, old man.
Introductions were made. Alfonso de Castagna impressed Garin little. He didn't believe in men who claimed to change lead into gold and cure all disease with an elixir of life. The alchemist gestured for Garin to have a seat on a wicker chaise padded with damask fabric, or even look about if he desired. He and Rue had matters to discuss. That suited Garin well and fine, though he did wish for something to drink. He was parched. A glance about convinced him the discolored liquids in the assorted vials, alembics, and glass pitchers were likely not consumable. The room was compact, yet the ceiling high and vaulted. It was packed to every wall with items of interest.
More than 4 walls. 6. Interesting.
Dusty vases, stacks of leathered books, and globes of thin glass covered every available space, along with intricate metal devices to calibrate and measure. Books were open everywhere, some marked with a shard of bone, others tilting nearly off a table. Garin glanced across the room. His master studied a kris blade with a bejeweled ivory handle. A glint of ruby caught sunlight beaming through a grilled window. Rue did like unique weapons. Garin stroked his fingers over a folded cloth run through with silver threading. curious things. Unnecessary to him, but still, they were something to behold. A small brass key tied through with a shimmery pink ribbon went untouched, for something marvelous caught Garin's attention. He reached carefully behind a stack of leather-bound books and palmed the curved shape of a skull. It was not a man's skull, for it fit upon his palm.
A child's?
It looked like the many other skulls he had seen as he and Rue ambled over the high roads for days without end. Skulls attached to skeletons and hanging from a gallows or tree, or sitting upon a desk or windowsill in declaration of the dark arts. The bone was creamy pale and smooth. The scalp was delineated into sections, and the pieces were held together by some kind of dirty plaster. The eye sockets were large in comparison to the skull, and the jaw quite small. It was missing the lower jawbone. It surely belonged to an infant.
Does the alchemist practice the dark arts?
Garin glanced yet again at the two men. De Castagna wore a white turban, and his skin was brown, yet paler than most Moors. His voice was kind. He gestured gracefully with long fingers as he spoke. Rue had mentioned something about De Castagna having angels and demons at his beck and call.
What foul deeds men get their hands to.
Garin turned the skull on his palm, smoothing his fingers over the slick bone. Poking two fingers into the eye sockets, he did it only because of curiosity. Hooked upon his fingers, he turned the skull and found the tiny hole at the base where it must attach to the spine. For no reason other than it was what his hands next decided to do, he lifted the upturned skull to his ear. His master fit the kris blade into the leather belt at his waist and glanced at his charge.
What have you there, boy?
No, pull it down, boy. His secrets are not for you to know.
Rue cast him a fierce eye. Not a look Garin ever wished to challenge. He set the skull on the books, yet his fingers lingered, as did Rue's gaze upon the skull.
It whispers to me.
The alchemist leaned in and snatched the skull from its perch and gave it a smart toss, catching it on his palm.
Not yet, boy. Not yet.
But I...
There was nothing more to say. His master shuffled him toward the stringed wooden beads marking the entrance.
Take yourself out to the Serrallo, apprentice. I'll follow directly.
Casting the skull a desirous glance, Garin licked his lips. He met the alchemist's eyes and thought sure he'd seen a star blink in the center of each dark orb.
Someday, perhaps. Someday, all good things.
Garin rushed outside. The open-air Serrallo beamed brilliant white sun upon his face, altering his mood for the better. Moments later, he was joined by his master. Rue laid out plans to ride to the city and find a meal. Fine and well. Yet Garin's thoughts tried to form sense of the mysterious whispers from the skull.
All good things, someday.
The season's first snow smacked Anya's cheek with a sharp bite. Glad she'd had the forethought to tug on a ski cap and warm jacket, she stalked onto the Carroll Street Bridge. The traffic was sparse. Few cars crossed the Gowanus Canal at this bridge. Anya glanced up and read the antique sign hanging overhead on the steel girders. Ordinance of the city. Any person driving over this bridge faster than a walk will be subject to a penalty of $5 per offense.
You gotta love New York.
Anya had walked from her loft. A quick walk in brisk weather always lifted her spirits, until the chill set in, and it was nippy tonight. But she was not one to resist a mystery when it involved an artifact. Only that afternoon, Anya had received a desperate email from someone using the screen name Sneak. She didn't know the person, just suspected he was a he. He'd followed her conversations at alt.archaeology.esoterica and felt she could give him some answers about something he'd found, a skull. Skulls were more common than gold coins in the archaeological world. There was a skull in every myth, every legend, every thrilling adventure tale told. Sneak hadn't sent a picture, claiming his digital camera had been broken in a recent fall. But his mention of a dig in Spain grabbed Anya's attention. He thought he held an important artifact, yet also feared people wanted to take it from him. He couldn't possibly know its value enough to cause worry, unless he had stolen it from a dig. If she'd learned anything over the past few years, it was to trust no one. Everyone played the game. The goal was to win. But she had a gut feeling about this guy. He wasn't trying to pull something on her. She sensed no malice. And she was really curious about the artifact, which he'd only said was rumored to be 12th century and mystical.
A 900-year-old skull? No way am I gonna let this one slip out of my hands.
Miss Creed?
What?
A tall, slender man strode down the plank sidewalk, hugging the bridge. Dressed in close-fitted black, the straps and buckles about his upper thighs and ankles gave his attire a militant look. She didn't see any weapons. Just because she couldn't see any didn't mean he wasn't carrying. Hands loose at her sides, but ready to call her sword to hand, Anya waited for him to approach her. They'd agreed to meet here, a quiet spot easily accessed by both parties.
Thank you for meeting me. We must be quick.
You think someone followed you? Why?
I can't be sure, but better safe than not. I'm glad you came, Anya. I wasn't sure you would. I didn't want to give any information over the internet.
Except that you found a skull.
Anya glanced around as a silver Honda crept slowly past, obviously not wanting to risk the hardship of the $5 fine, but still marking her to the ankle with muddy water.
You're not going to pull it out right here. There's a cafe a couple of blocks from the west end of the bridge.
Sneak's eyes scanned their periphery, his fingers clutched at his backpack straps nervously. Anya didn't like the vibes he was giving off. At once, she sensed a strange tingle to the air. It was the man's weird anxiety, she told herself. It was bleeding off him and onto her.
Just be cool. Who would be watching?
Putting her back to the street, she paralleled him and looked out over the water.
Tell me how you obtained the thing.
That's not important, but I can tell you this.
He leaned forward. Anya stepped closer.
I was hired to pass this along to a specific individual. It is what I do.
Thieves passed things along to others. Anya coiled her fingers, imagining the sword in her grip, but did not call it forth.
But I have a terrible feeling about this job. Something isn't right. That's why I wanted your opinion. Maybe you can identify...
His gaze shot up. He stumbled backward. Anya spied the hole in his forehead. Sniper shot. She directed his staggering movement to swing around her body and stand before her as a defensive wall. Ice burned along Anya's neck. She'd been hit, but it didn't slow her down. Leaning backward over the railing, she slapped both arms around the man's shoulders. And then she pushed from the sidewalk with her feet. The water was only slightly warmer than frozen. Anya immediately struggled with the backpack straps. The first one proved difficult. She couldn't get the tight strap over the man's shoulder. Anya jerked on the backpack strap and tugged it from the man's arm. His body felt twice as heavy now. He was sinking fast, taking her with him as she struggled to release his other lifeless arm. Thanks to some trapped air, the backpack floated, and Anya hooked it over an arm and bent her elbow. Kicking, she headed toward the surface, but quickly decided to change course for the murky shadows to her right. The icy air pierced like needles at the back of her throat. She bit on a nasty piece of something she didn't care to identify. A kick of her legs slammed her against the slimy log bulkhead hugging the bridge girder. Shivering, she pushed the hair from her eyes. She wanted to climb out, but didn't know if the sniper would still be watching. She couldn't risk the chance of emerging in plain sight. She'd have to swim downstream as far as possible. The murky water and her position under the bridge made it impossible to see, but she didn't need to see. It wasn't as though she'd run into a boat or shark down here. A slight lightening in the water signaled she'd cleared the bridge. keeping close to what she felt was the shore. She kicked swiftly and stroked with her free right arm, while maintaining a secure clutch on the backpack with her left. What seemed like an hour in the water was probably more like 15 minutes. It was 14 minutes too long. Emerging, she dragged herself up along the mooring of old timbers lashed together with slimy rope. Slipping around behind the mooring put her next to a dock. The backpack no longer floated. It snagged on a branch. No, it was a hook of rebar. Anya tugged, but the rebar held her prize securely. It was close to the surface. Deciding to get out from the water and struggle with the backpack then, she heaved herself up. Using the rope wrappings around the moorings, she managed to slap a hand onto the dock. A warm, leather-gloved hand gripped her wrist.
What?
Huh? And reeled her in like a giant fish. She was able to stand for 2 seconds. Anya's frozen brain was dimly aware of a figure leaning over her. Reflexively, she aimed a kick at his head. The hood of his jacket fell away to reveal a bald head. Anya turned and pushed to her knees, swinging out her right hand. Joan of Arc's sword appeared in her hand, solid and reassuring. She blindly swung backward.
Must not have expected the fish to bite back.
Sending the sword away, Anya crawled to the water's edge and dipped a hand into the canal. Her fingers hooked the backpack strap. It came free of the rebar with a tug. Lying sprawled, her hand gripping the heavy backpack, she closed her eyes.
Do other women spend their Saturday nights like this?
Standing, her body shivering and her steps moving her in zigzags across the ground, Anya didn't look back. If the man lying on the ground was the sniper, she wanted to get out of his range before he came to. Her lungs thudded like heavy chunks of ice against her ribs, and the muscles in her legs felt as if they'd been stretched like taffy. She wasn't far from home. When a cab pulled alongside her, Anya hugged the icy yellow vehicle before crawling into the back seat. Harris looked at his phone in disgust before hanging up. The sniper had agreed to contact him with details of the skull's whereabouts and keep him posted about each move Cook made. He wasn't supposed to fire a shot unless the man holding the skull looked as though he would hand it over to someone else. Cook hadn't even gotten the thing out of his backpack. Harris, from his vantage point on a building half a mile down the canal, bit back a growl as the pair went over the railing, taking the skull with them.
Idiot. Ravenscroft must have hired the sniper. That man knows so little about field work.
Tucking the cell phone inside his jacket, Harris eyed the brick-fronted warehouse where he knew the sniper had been positioned. The shooter should be long gone. 5 minutes later, Harris topped the fourth-floor stairs in the abandoned warehouse, picking his way through debris of broken glass and sheetrock. An icy breeze whipped up his collar and froze his face. At the far end of the warehouse, he saw the M16 rifle still set upon a tripod. He rushed through the darkness and stopped before he tripped over a man's body.
What the hell?
Inspection found no ID on the body. He wore black leather gloves and shooting glasses.
No blood. Looks like someone broke his neck.
Harris scanned the hazy darkness in a circle around him. Whoever had taken out the sniper could still be lurking.
Did Ravenscroft send his own backup?
It made no sense at all. This was merely a surveillance job. Keep an eye on Cook and make sure he doesn't do anything rash between the time he landed in New York and met Ravenscroft for the handoff. Harris scrubbed a hand over his scalp. Anything and everything had gone wrong.
Ravenscroft is not gonna like this one bit.
The cabbie had argued fiercely for a generous tip after he'd seen Anya was dripping wet and smelled like something he'd dredged out of his rain gutter last week. Good thing the 20 she'd stuffed in her back pocket had survived the swim. Dropping the backpack inside the door of her loft, Anya made a beeline through the living room for the bathroom. Twisting the spigot, she let the shower run for a few minutes to warm up. Stripping away her wet clothes, she caught a glance of herself in the vanity mirror. Her lips were blue, as was the fine skin under her eyes. Tilting her head up, she stroked the bruised skin on her neck. An abrasion practically glowed red in contrast to the chilled white skin near the base of her earlobe. The bullet had skimmed her flesh, but hadn't drawn blood.
Lucky girl. Ah.
To touch it hurt worse than actually getting the wound. Twisting the water faucet adjusted the temperature, and she climbed into the shower, but was too weak to stand any longer. Settling into the tub in a self-hug, she let the warmth spill over her aching, half-frozen muscles. A half hour later, with a mug of hot chocolate in hand and some warm flannel pajama bottoms and her Dodgers sweatshirt on, the final shivers tickled her spine. Anya squatted on the floor before the waterlogged backpack. It reeked of things she'd rather not consider. Things she had washed down the shower drain.
This is a complete loss. Good thing it wasn't mine.
Setting the mug on the hardwood floor, she then unzipped the pack. Water dripped out from the inside, but not a lot. Inspecting the tag on the outer rim of the zipper teeth, she read it was designed for hiking and was waterproof.
Good deal.
Tools and a metal-edged leather box were tucked inside. The tools she took out and examined, placing them on the floor in a line. The assortment included a handheld drill with a battery pack dripping water, a glass cutter, a small screwdriver, a few flash drives, a wide-blade utility knife, soft cotton gloves, only slightly wet, a stethoscope, and a small set of lock picks in a folding black leather case. Anya wondered if the flash drives would dry out enough to attempt to read. She wasn't sure she wanted to risk an electrical failure by inserting the memory sticks into her laptop.
Who would use stuff like this?
Instinct said thief, but she couldn't figure why a thief would steal something like an ancient skull if they had little idea of its value. Though Sneak had said he'd been hired to bring this to someone, and he feared that someone. Too tired to push her reasoning beyond simple deductions, Anya decided to sleep on it. But not until she'd opened the box. Secured with a small padlock, the box was made of a hardwood edged in thin metal. The wood was covered with pounded black leather, impressed with a houndstooth design. It didn't look old, only expensive. Anya eyed the lockpicks tucked inside the leather pouch. She'd never used anything like them before, but had read a few internet articles on how to manipulate the pins inside a lock with a pick.
A girl could use a set like this. Definitely something to hang on to.
The padlock was simple enough. She might fiddle around with the picks, but would get nowhere. The wood box was hard, like ironwood, and she was glad for that. Hopefully, it had kept the water from seeping inside. Forgoing any burgeoning lock-picking skills, she picked up the knife and rocked the tip of it around the metal edging. Small finishing nails secured each end of the metal strips. She managed to pry off two sides, and another, until the entire top square of wood could be removed.
So much for the security of a padlock.
A fluff of sheep's wool poofed out of the open box.
Good. Still dry.
Carefully plucking out the packing revealed the top of a skull. Anya drew it out and held it upon both palms.
An infant skull.
It wasn't uncommon to unearth infants and children's skulls on a dig. She did it all the time. But it didn't make holding something so small and so precious less agonizing. Switching to the analytical and less emotional side of her brain, Anya inspected the prize. The bone had a nice polish to it. The cranium was over-large compared to the facial bones. Large eye sockets dominated the face. The lower jawbone, the mandible, was missing. The parietal and frontal bones, normally joined with sutures, were instead held together by thin strips of gold. The anterior, posterior, sphenoid, and mastoid fontanelles, normally open spaces on an infant skull, were also filled with smooth, shiny gold.
Fancy. I wonder whose living room shelf this has gone missing from.
Turning it over and taking her time, Anya smoothed her fingers over the surface, feeling for abrasions or gouges. There were no markings on the exterior bone that she could find. Sometimes knife marks remained after a ceremonial removing of the scalp. The gold lining the plates was fascinating enough. No dirt. It didn't smell as if it had been freshly unearthed. It was musty, but clean. Except for the gold, it looked an average skull, so stained with age that Anya estimated it to be a few centuries old at the least. There were no teeth in the upper maxilla, nor did it look as though there had ever been teeth. She had to wonder if it could be newborn.
So sad.
Retrieving a digital camera from the pile of clutter on her desk, Anya placed the skull on top of a stack of hardcover research books. She snapped shots of the skull from all angles. When the flash caught the small gold triangular posterior fontanelle section, she noticed the anomaly in the smooth metal.
So there is a mark.
Sneak had mentioned a curious marking in his email. Holding the skull close to the desk light, she squinted to view the small impression in the shiny gold.
Aha!
A cross patee was impressed in the gold. She had seen it many times, researching Renaissance and medieval battles, religions, and even jewelry. It was a square cross capped with triangular ends. It did not always signify a religious connection, and some even associated it with fairies or pirates. The Knights Templar had worn a similar cross on their tabards. The cross patee was more a Teutonic symbol than Templar, she knew that. The Templar's red cross on white background tended to vary in design. That set her original guess of a few centuries back, perhaps to the 13th or 14th century. Sneak had thought it was 12th century. It was possible. Or the skull could be contemporary. She wouldn't know until she could get it properly dated. And Anya knew the professor who could help. But first, she'd send out feelers to her own network. If the skull had been stolen from a dig, someone would be looking for it. Powering up her laptop, she inserted the digital card from the camera into the card reader to load the photos she'd taken. As she waited for the program to open, Anya wondered again about the man on the bridge. Something Sneak said now niggled at her. He'd been hired to hand this over to a specific individual and had a bad feeling about it. Anya envisioned a body found floating in the Gowanus Canal come morning. It wasn't as though it never happened. Heck, the canal was rumored to have once been the Mafia's favorite dumping grounds. She considered her options. Bart McGilly was a friend who served on the NYPD as a detective. He knew trouble followed Anya far more closely than she desired and was accustomed to calls from her at odd hours of the night. He didn't know everything about her. Like, at certain times, she could be found defending herself with a kick-ass medieval sword. And after successfully dispatching the threat, the sword would then simply disappear into a strange otherwhere Anya still couldn't describe or place. Anya retrieved her mug from the floor and took a sip. Cold. But still, it was chocolate. She leaned over the laptop. The photo program allowed her to choose a few good shots of the anterior and lateral views and close-ups of the gold on the fontanelles. Signing on to her favorite archaeology site, Anya posted the pictures along with a note about a friend showing her the skull. She wouldn't make up a story about finding it on a dig because that could get her in trouble. She had no idea where this had come from.
I'll check back in the morning.
Before signing off, she searched the Carroll Street Bridge to see if it had security cameras. It didn't, which wouldn't help her sleuth out who she had spoken to, but proved excellent should the sniper want to track her. On the other hand, if the sniper and the bald guy were indeed two different people, the sniper may have tracked her home. Flicking aside the curtain, Anya scanned the street below. Car headlights blurred in the snow that had turned to sleet and rain. No mysterious figures lurking. She picked up the phone to call Bart. It was past midnight, but she dialed anyway. Bart's answering machine took her cryptic message about swimming the canal with a stranger. He'd call her in the morning for sure. With one last inspection over the skull, she decided to forego doing an internet search on random skulls. That would bring up more hits than her sleepy eyelids could manage. Instead, she flicked off the desk light and wandered into her bedroom. It hadn't felt so good to crawl between warm blankets in a long time. In the meeting room, attached to a 50th floor corner office overlooking Central Park, a crew of three cameramen noisily went about setting up for a photo shoot. A top business magazine had declared Benjamin Ravenscroft CEO of the Year. They wanted to flash his mug across their pages, and he was obliged to agree. He'd gotten an email that morning regarding the Fortune 500 list. Another photo shoot was imminent. The entrepreneur's company, Raven's Tech, had risen from the detritus of struggling dot-coms over the past year. CNN had crowned him master of the intangible assets. Raven's Tech now held weekly cyber auctions for intellectual property rights, such as patents, trademarks, and copyrights. They'd netted $600 million last year, and this year looked to double that figure. Just goes to show what a little roll-up-your-sleeves ingenuity can do for a man. And the proper connections, he thought, as he waited to be photographed.
10 minutes and we'll be ready for you, Mr. Ravenscroft.
Ravenscroft waved a slim black clove cigarette at the photographer, who then disappeared inside the meeting room. Leaning against the edge of his granite-topped desk, ankles crossed, the businessman tucked the grit between his lips and inhaled. He had the cigarettes imported from Indonesia. He'd become addicted to them during his college days, when he'd sit through the night, eyes glued to the computer monitor, as he shopped his way through available domain names. He'd made millions nabbing domains. Another intangible. He loved buying and selling things a person could not physically hold, touch, or see. He tapped the calendar on his iPhone. He verified two meetings that afternoon, accountant and marketing. Both would be a breeze. Another tap. The plans for the Berlin office were due to arrive before noon by courier.
Where the hell are they?
He eyed his secretary's desk through the glass wall that separated their offices. With a touch of a button on his desk, the electrochromic glass would turn white, granting privacy. A necessary amenity. Rebecca was on the phone, her red hair spilled over one satin-clad shoulder. She would notify him as soon as the Berlin plans arrived. Lunch with her in the meeting room, her legs hooked over his shoulders, was scheduled for 12:15. He hadn't scheduled Harris in, but he expected him before noon as well. Not the best time to arrive with the photographer in the next room, but Ben was anxious to get his hands on what Harris had retrieved. He twisted and eyed the blurry photograph on the desktop. The skull had been removed from a glass display case, and a glare from the glass blurred part of the photo.
Good things. Soon.
But the day would give him a migraine if he didn't dose on Imitrex before facing the camera's bright lights. And tonight, he had to leave the office early to arrive home in time to tuck his daughter in for bed. He and his wife had agreed he'd make a concerted effort to be home at least twice a week to do so. He hadn't tucked Rachel in for more than a month. He sent a text message to his secretary. Send flowers to wife. White roses, 2 dozen. As he hit send, Rebecca buzzed on the intercom.
Mr. Harris is here for you, Ben. Sir.
Thank you, Rebecca. Send him in.
Stepping over to assure the photographer he'd be right in, Ben closed the meeting room door and strolled to his desk. He snubbed out the cigarette in an ashtray. He settled into the leather chair that had put him out a mere 10 grand. It heated the lumbar area and massaged overall. It also included a heart monitor and blood pressure cuff. It had been worth every penny. A man could forget his whole family sitting in this thing. But never Rebecca. That's where the ultra-vibrating function came in handy. Harris entered the massive office and offered a respectful bow, hands pressed together before his mouth like some kind of besuited samurai. The heavy oak door closed slowly on hydraulics behind him. The white-haired behemoth looked completely out of his element in the ill-fitted navy blue suit and red tie. He did not carry a briefcase or box.
Where is it, sir?
Harris bowed again. He fingered the gaudy red tie strangling his thick neck. His glance around the room, as if checking for trespassers hidden behind the potted cactus or narrowed behind the blinds, revealed his anxiety.
There was an altercation.
I don't like the sound of that, Harris. Either Cook was apprehended or he was not. I don't see anything on your person which would indicate you retrieved the artifact, so I'm gonna go out on a limb and guess you failed me.
Sir, there was a woman.
Before or after you began to trail Cook? I don't need to hear about your amorous liaisons, Harris, and I certainly hope you were not entertaining the flavor of the week on my time.
I would never, Mr. Ravenscroft. Cook didn't go immediately home from the airport. He met a woman on the old Carroll Street Bridge. He must have arranged for them to meet before arriving in the States.
Cook had come highly recommended after Sergei had worked his magic. Ben did not tolerate those who tried to screw with him.
The sniper followed the backup plan as discussed.
Good.
The artifact, unfortunately, was sacrificed in the process.
Damn it!
Harris approached the desk and reached inside his suit coat. He placed a black and white photograph on Ben's desk.
The sniper got this. He sent it to me on my cell phone. Then I lost contact with him.
Not picking it up, but instead drawing the slightly curved photo toward him with the edge of his thumb, Ben leaned over the image. It was blurred, but some details showed on the two faces. He recognized Cook from the one meeting he'd arranged during an art exhibit at a gallery in the village. There was enough clarity to ascertain the figure talking to Cook was indeed a woman. A dark ski cap hugged her head. Prominent cheekbones suggested beauty. Mouth open as if talking, she couldn't have known her conversation was being observed. Something about her was familiar, but he couldn't recall seeing her in person. He attended so many damned parties, he felt sure he'd slapped palms with half of New York over the past year alone. The door to his right opened. The photographer shoved his head through.
Ready, Mr. Ravenscroft?
5 minutes. What happened?
After the sniper shots, they went over the bridge railing.
He got them both?
We're still waiting to verify the bodies, sir.
Ben rolled his eyes and pushed back in the chair.
And the sniper's gone?
No.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.